I'm going to continue to make some tiny little remarks on our first thinking, and as is concluding actually parts, I view you or this tiny little article. One of the first on Lacan, actually, that's why it was important, on Freud and Lacan, entitled so as well. I'm not going to talk about it much, simply because, as Althusser himself stated, it is nothing else than a promotionary kind of article for the members of the Communist Party about thinking of psychoanalytic thinking, so to speak, of Freud and Lacan. Okay? Its importance was actually to show you that particular role played by Althusser in those times to promote all those, not all those perhaps, but some eminent at least thinkers later known as post-structuralists, okay, into the French Academia. Jacques Lacan, for instance, all this plays in the Academia to Althusser's efforts, so on and so forth. As for Althusser's own rather not so much coherent thinking, okay, one point I would like to make is this, that Althusser's writings caused a kind of unrest among the ranks of the left of the time. Simply because a huge debate began to develop out of his writings as for the compatibility of structuralism and Marxist thinking. And Althusser was stigmatized, so to speak, around the Marxist circles as the one who tries to introduce structuralism. Okay? So what stands structuralism for in Althusser's thinking, do we think? Actually, if you ask me, at the time I was resistant against the idea that Althusser was writing under the influence of structuralist thinking, but later on I began increasingly convinced that he was, if not true and true structuralist, he was quite influenced by structuralist ideas. Okay. Well, before passing to Lacan, let's first take a look at what sort of structuralism he was operating under. Okay. No, not exactly. Actually, more important than that, his division of the social formation, his conception of social formation and division of that entity which he referred as social formation into instances, you know. Actually, the idea was originally coming from Karl Marx's writings himself, okay. But, you know, tiny little modifications, or if not modifications, tiny little emphases or differences in accent, so to speak, okay, led Althusser carry over structuralist influences into Marxism. It appears so. I told you that Althusser had elaborated the famous Marxist notion, mode of production. As a theoretical concept. The term theoretical concepts, concept having a significant meaning for Althusser, implying that you should never look to the actual reality with the hope of finding that theoretical concept as the theory explains it in its pure state. Okay? So therefore he introduced the notion of social formation. Okay? And in his language, the term social formation, again borrowed from Marx himself, okay, social formation as distinct from a theoretical concept,
refer to the actual historical constitution of any given particular society. Okay. Now the debate was about this. Okay. How far a given society can be understood, okay, by making use simply of the concept mode of production. Okay. So say for instance Turkish society at the 21st century. Okay. So when we are talking about social formation, we are talking about an actual society, an actual historical society at a certain stage in its historical transformation. Okay, fine, all right. Now making use of the notion of mode of production, which Marx gives us certain varieties, you know, primitive, commune, slave, mode of production, what else, feudal, capitalist, and perhaps in the future socialist, and perhaps communist mode. Okay. So, but the problem, as I told you earlier, that this actual social formation did include elements, even though you may characterize it as predominantly determined by a certain mode of production, it may be one of these, okay, does not make much difference perhaps for our purposes at least. Okay, say feudal. Okay. When you are going out there into that society and conducting research, you'll find out that there are other elements, okay. There are other elements which you cannot associate directly with that definite mode of production which you think that predominating the relations of production in a given society. Okay. So say for instance the rising bourgeoisie at the bottom of the feudal society. Perhaps as the herald of the future mode of production, a future social formation which will be expected to be predominated by another mode of production, namely the capitalist mode of production here in the example. Okay? So when you go out there, it means that practically, it's quite easy to understand an idea, practically you wouldn't be able to find pure example of any given mode of production which mode of productions being themselves theoretical concepts, okay? So functioning kind of ideal types here, okay? And it is pure theoretically produced form, okay? However, historical societies do divert from that pure forms in this or that direction, okay? Doesn't matter what, okay? This forces Althusser actually to concentrate on the problematic relationship between the characters of characteristics of a given social formation, which corresponds and which do not correspond to a given concept of mode of production. Okay. So how are you gonna work them out? Turns out to be a problem. Okay, and to be able to solve this problem, as we have seen, Althusser emphasized an already existing idea in Marx's writings himself, okay, the idea of the social instances, or if you like, levels. Now, instances turns out to be the components, you know, components of a whole to which Althusser refers as social formation. Okay. However, these components are structurally related with each other on the one hand, as Marx had already implied in his analysis or discussion of the relationship between superstructure and infrastructure. The problem was that, in the orthodox Marxist view, was to establish one-to-one corresponding relationship between the elements of the superstructure and elements of infrastructure. Now, Althusser, by directing our attention to those components of a social formation which may not necessarily correspond to the predominant mode of production in that social formation, okay, actually bringing our attention the problem of the levels and how they are related with each other. Okay. Say economic, social, political, social, okay, political, let's follow here, Parsons. And theoretico ideological. It was their interaction that brought about the historical actual social formation, okay? Now, however, you know, actually here, if we presuppose a fixed kind of relationship between those components, okay, you'll get the idea of the pure and simple structure. Okay. We are talking about a constituent whole, whose constituent components entering into a fixed forms of relationship with each other. Okay. This level affecting the other level in this or that way, while that level affecting the others in these or that levels. You know, if you have four different levels, what you would get as an analysis, within the analysis of a social formation, would be quite a complex web of relations. Okay, for instance, theoretical, ideological, relating to social, political, economic relating to political, social, theoretical, ideological, etc., etc. Okay. But the problem was that if you presuppose such kind of fixed relationship between them, okay, the empirical research would not support your finding. If you are going to say, for instance, that was therefore why I was saying it, that a practical problem, okay? For instance, okay, let's assume that here we would have feudal relations of production. If you are supposing the existence of a fixed relationship with the other instances of that particular instance, what you will get is nothing else than the expectancy that these feudal relations of production producing their reflections on other levels, right? So what you are going to expect a feudal in political as well, feudal political relations, in social, feudal social relations, in theoretical ideological, ideological and theoretical forms corresponding to the feudal relations of production, let's say. Okay. But when you go out there, as any sociologist would do, okay, and Marxists themselves, okay, when you go out there and study the society, you would have experienced serious hardships in establishing that kind of relationship between the legal structure of any given country and say, the relations of production. Okay. It doesn't work. So Althusser introduces the idea of the relative autonomy, décalage, okay, relative autonomy of the instances. Actually, by this step, I think he comes closest to what we may call post-structuralism, simply because this simple idea of relative autonomy of the instances is that exactly which having the potential of destroying the unity of what we call a social whole, or what we call a social formation here, or what you may call a social structure. Okay. Now, the basic tenet of post-structuralism revolving around the issue of this destructive effect, actually. Okay. For instance, let's take a look back at what Saussure was saying as his most famous formula. Okay. The value of the sign, we are talking about the value, actually roughly corresponding to the meaning, which he differentiated, remember, from signification. Signification referring to the usage of the word. Later on, we will associate that term, signification, with another term, performative. Okay, so it can wait for that later period. For the time being, we are talking about the value of a sign. Okay. The difference of that sign from the other signs in a signifying chain. Okay. Now, however, if I assume that signifying chain is constant, okay, without any change, you would easily arrive at the idea that the value of the sign has already been fixed. Okay? So, for instance, that dog means dog without any other connotations. Okay? The value of the dog is it's not being cat, not being mice, not being crow, not being lion, etc., etc. Okay? You can enumerate as much as many names as you like. All the other signs are included as well, okay, in the determination of the value of a one single particular sign. So the value of a sign calls all the other signs into the analysis. Okay? But if that relationship is fixed, if that signifying change is fixed, you will see that each and every time in your analysis, you will get the same signified. No? But if there is a possibility that the signs are continuously proliferating, okay, as in the case of this idea of social formation. Okay? Now, when I, for instance, have only these theoretical series of concepts, modes of production, okay, I have a definite number of signs. Right? But when I shift my analysis to the analysis of social formation, now this fixed number of signs had disappeared. Okay, will disappear. Why? Simply because I do not know beforehand what would I get from my analysis of the social formation. Okay? How many new elements will appear in this analysis, I do not know. This practically means that, okay, the number of signs in such kind of signifying chains are not predetermined. Okay? Which means that in the historical process of the constitution of that structure, some of the signs, while they may disappear, some other signs may appear, come into the picture. Okay. This means that when I am trying to assess the value of a particular sign, okay, actually, as signifying chain, what I do refer is not a pre-given, predetermined entity. Okay. Which causing each and every time of the analysis a perhaps significant shift in the value of that sign I am trying to concentrate on. Okay? Therefore, no fixed value remains at my hands. Therefore, each and every time I require to reconduct the analysis. Okay? To be able to assess the value of, for instance, the value of the sign, for instance, the value of the economic instance in relation to other instances. Now, the instances may proliferate as well as the components finding themselves categorized under one of the instances may differ. Okay? So this means that actually this, such an argumentation is indeed opening the way towards a kind of post-structuralist thinking, and as well as at the same time showing its destructive effect on the idea of the completed totality. Okay? So the effect, the destructive effect, returns back to onto the possibility of the application of the concept, theoretical concept, mode of production. It was therefore I said to you that Althusser, without not willing to take that last destructive step, actually returned back to insist on the ultimate determinacy by the economic level, for instance. Okay. Something should hold this. In other words, something should hold this totality as totality. Otherwise, as I try to show you, okay, the whole unity of what we call, forget about mode of production, it was theoretical concept, okay? But the whole unity of what we call social formation is about to be destroyed. Okay. We have seen that such an analysis, such an insertion of the idea of relative instances into the whole called social formation, okay, involves two-dimensional destruction on the idea of the whole of the social formation. First of all, it destroys its temporal unity. Okay, actually, the whole argument started from this. Out of the requirement of understanding, assessing the value of the remnants, you know, say, under capitalism, the remnants of the feudal mode of production. Okay, we were trying to assess the value of it. Why? Because we were trying to decide what kind of mode of production can be said to predominate in a given social formation. Okay? Say, for instance, for the 21st century Turkish society, we could say capitalist mode of production. Well, you see, when you go out to society, you see many elements within this society which you cannot directly associate with capitalist mode of production. Okay. Say the existence of the landlords, say the existence of the enforced labor, say the existence of the kinship relations predominating the life of a particular group of individuals, say the tribal relations, etc., etc. Okay. So how are you going to value, assess the value of these within the larger whole? Okay. Now you are saying that since the instances are relative, okay, they would have this different historical paces of transformation. Okay. In other words, their speed of change is different. Okay. But in such a case, okay, in such a case, you would get, say, an instance pertaining to the capitalist mode of production, while another instance pertaining to another mode of production. Actually, stripping you from the ability of saying that this society, that particular social formation, is predominated by this or by that mode of production. And worse still, okay, the components of this social formation does not represent being the components of a particular social historical whole. Okay. They belong to different totalities happening to find themselves together in this particular constitution which we refer here as the Turkish social formation at the 21st century, for instance. Okay, so this temporal destruction of unity at the same time yielding the result of a spatial destruction of the unity. Okay, with which part of the country are you gonna call as the capitalist Turkish society, for instance? Okay, Are you going to call some distant part of the country, some tiny little village where still kinship relations are predominant with domestic economy, for instance, as part and parcel of the Turkish capitalist social formation? Okay. Are you going to, for instance, say the tribal ideology, see the tribal ideology as part of the capitalist social formation of Turkish society? Now, there are difficulties, and as you can see, if we push the idea further, what we will get is nothing else than the distribution of the whole, which we refer as society or social formation. Therefore, the last sentence about was that no society is possible. Okay? So I guess this was considered to be, can be considered as the real serious impact in Althusser's thought of structuralism, okay? Actually paving the way for in his last works, giving up of Marx himself. Okay. We're now going to see another example of such a situation in case of Lacan. We have seen already how destructive psychoanalysis could be in our discussion of Sigmund Freud's ideas. Okay. Everything else put aside, okay, the very and simple idea of psychoanalysis turns out to be quite destructive, okay, in our so far beautifully constituted conceptions of understanding, thinking, consciousness, mind, etc., spirit, etc., okay. Now, what turns out to be at stake here is the very destruction of the Kantian consciousness, very destruction of the happily proceeding conceptualization of spirit in Hegel's thinking. Okay? The spirit turns out to be something stupid. If not stupid, something already lacking any kind of integrity at all from the very beginning. Okay? And actually, introduction of the consciousness with regard to Hegelian conception of spirit already implies that, I'm sorry for that, but already implies that this spirit can never know itself, simply because the spirit can never present itself to itself in any possible complete form. From the beginning, it lacks this completeness, this wholeness, and up to the end, this lack determines its movements. Okay? And there will be no hope. Hegel was developing his theory with the hope, or wishful thinking, if you like, okay, a hope of arriving at the absolute knowledge. Now, with the introduction of the notion of unconscious, however, you come to realize that such a possibility is simply an impossibility. Okay? It is not possible simply because the spirit itself can never be a whole, never be a complete, always lacking something. And the strange point with unconscious was that, okay, even though psychoanalysis may claim to study unconscious, as Freud himself confesses, nobody knows about unconscious. Okay, that was the basic problem. Actually, a problem set by unconscious before us, and this problem was nothing less than a very serious ontological problem. Okay? Pointing out the possibility of gaps, blackouts in the what we tend to think the unity of existence. Okay? The existence cannot be understood any longer as forming, constituting a unity, in other words. If it is not unity, what kind of consequences you can expect from it? If it is not unity, it means we can no longer talk about any universal laws. Okay. Talking about universal laws turns out to be meaningless. Okay. Simply because the laws valid here may not be valid over there. Okay. And worse still, okay, since this board, think about the board as if it is the unity of existence, okay, is no longer a unity, okay, we can never know what has been written on the other parts of the board which we do not see. Okay. So Lacan enters into the picture through this argumentation. Okay, he was a follower of Sigmund Freud, and actually even in Freud's time, Freud's own time, and later on, psychoanalysis had been divided in itself. Okay, several branches, some critical against Freud, Freud struggling against them, some misunderstanding and misinterpreting. I don't know what these means. Mis means here. Okay. Some misinterpreting psychoanalysis, Freudian psychoanalysis in different ways, especially in America and England, Anglo-Saxon countries, as their usage, always understanding what is continental in a rather shallow way, etc. Fine, all right. And Lacan comes into the picture as a call to return back to the Freud's writings himself. Okay, there are so much confusion here about psychoanalysis, its future, its methods, its conceptualizations, etc., etc. Okay, let's return back to read Freud in a rather serious way. Okay. In that regard, first I'm going to introduce you some of the Lacanian concepts, and later on I'll try to establish connections with the Lacanian call for returning back to Freud. Okay, but first Lacanian conceptualization of psychoanalysis. You know, at about the early 1950s, as far as I remember, it was sometime 1952, 1955, I don't remember the exact date, Lacan published an article in which he introduced a certain concept which is called the mirror image. Okay. Actually, the idea is very simple. I don't know this, if it is a fact, but about this is, this argument is about the children of some, as far as I remember, 6 to 18 months of age. And Lacan there claims that, I don't know if it is really so, so one has to ask for the child who, I don't know, child psychiatrist or what. So the process that we are going to deal with here right now is about to take place at the 6 to 18 months of age in child's life, okay, usually referred in this context infants. Okay. Lacan argues that at that age, while the child's cognitive capacities are developed enough, two major characteristics are at stake here. First, the continuity of objects. You know, I guess each and every one of you had such an experience when you are playing with a child. You hide your face, and child suddenly gets surprised and show your face, and he gets very what joyful to find you again. Okay, when you hide your face, the child thinks that you have disappeared. You no longer exist. Okay, show your face once again. Child gets a joy, enjoyment out of you finding you again there. Okay, so this game turns out to be a very pleasurable pastime between an adult and a child. Okay, here what's at stake is this. Okay, at an earlier stage, when somebody disappears from vision, okay, the child tends to think that it no longer exists. Okay, it's only gradual that the child comes to understand that what disappears from its vision do continue to exist. For instance, this board mark. Board marker. I put it here and you tend to think that it's no longer. I show you it once again, you suddenly get surprised that it was there. Okay, you gradually learn that when I put the board marker out of your sight, you still continue to think that the board marker still exists but not visible to you. Okay, so when I show you, it's no longer a surprise. The same board marker that I hide earlier now appears before your eyes. Okay, it is the same board marker. But this was not the case for the child. So a child learns this. Okay, plus another unit. As we have seen, this was the most important concept actually in Kantian, the whole tradition actually, from the very early. The unity of me, myself, okay? The unity of existence. Just a few moments ago we were talking about the unity of a social formation, etc. Okay? And we have seen its importance, it is productive power, so to speak, especially in Kant's his analysis. Okay, Kant was talking about the unifying power of the concept. Okay, it was through the operation of this unifying power of the concept actually we came to understand the world as unity. We came to understand our own selves or our own consciousness as constituting a coherent unity. Okay, and strange enough, if we do not present either our thoughts, our consciousness, our self, our subjectivity to us and to others in the form of unity, the result would be our recognition as men. Okay? The result would be the impossibility of communication. The result would be the impossibility of meaning. Okay? At all. If there is no unity, there is no meaning. However, we have already begun to challenge this unity. Remember here, Althusser or other structuralist ideas, the possibility of the proliferation of ideas in a signifying, science in a signifying chain. Actually, this already pointing in the direction of a unit, destruction of unity. The unity we are talking about, which had already been stated by Kant at much earlier time, he was saying, remember, the empirical self, the real self, okay? The real self does not display a unity, okay? And since it does not display a unity, it is nothing other than a manifold of flux of intuitions which themselves are unintelligible. In other words, the actual real self cannot be known, it means, okay? Why? Simply because it lacks unity. And because it lacks unity, it doesn't make any sense. Therefore, in your thinking, you are doomed to represent to your own thinking, your own self, in the form of as if it is having a unity. As if. This is why Kantian philosophy is sometimes referred as the as if philosophy. As if you are unity, you represent the world. As if the world is in unity, you represent them in a unified form. As if the objects are unity, constituting unity, you represent the objects in your thinking in the form of unity, okay? In actual reality, no, we don't know anything about it, okay? So as if all things are presented as unity, you come to produce, you come to be able to produce meanings, you come to be able to produce concepts, you come to be able to produce knowledge. Okay? If there is no unity, then no knowing, no consciousness, no awareness, no meaning at all. Now we are paving the way towards that direction, unfortunately. Okay? So this unity turns out to be one of the crucial abilities, constructing unity, assuming unity, attributing unity, turns out to be one of the crucial elements of this cognitive development of a child in this early age. But however, in contrast to this, the motor capacities another non-correspondence here, as you can see, between what has been represented or what is about to be represented and what actually is, okay? Motor capacities are not well developed in the lives of a child in these ages, okay? This means practically speaking, at that age, the child cannot control his own body in the form of a coordinated unity, okay? In other words, you know, those children who are not able to control their movements, who are not able to hold their head straight, the movement of their hands are not coordinated, they cannot walk, they cannot reach out something and grasp something for any possible purposeful action, etc., etc., okay? This is what I practically, or Lacan here is talking practically about, okay? Nothing mysterious. Yeah. So it means that the child has the capacity to conceive unity mentally, but not exercise unity in its own existence practically. Okay? Now, as you can see, this creates a gap. This gap will turn out to be quite important for later Lacanian analysis. So in that stage, then, the child entering into a rather intimate relationship with a certain significant other, usually, as you know, the mother. It is the mother in our societies, usually, who is taking care of the child. Okay, so that significant other in most of the cases turn out to be the mother, but you should not necessarily think that it is the mother in each and every case. Okay, any significant other taking care of the children at that point can play that role, or maybe not any, but one certain significant other, we can say. Okay, so this other is nothing else than in this intimate, affectionate relationship with child, okay, functions nothing else than the role of a mirror, okay? In other words, the child, as it is first social relationship, okay, sees himself on the face of the, or itself, better said, because we do not know the gender of the child, okay, itself on the face of that other, who functions as the mirror. Now, what this child sees here? At first, he confuses its own image with the image of the other. Later on, it gradually comes to differentiate these two images and trying to imitate the image of the other always and all the time, simply because the image of the other, either it corresponds to the image in the child of its own self-image or not, okay? Presents itself always in the form of a unity. Okay. So the well-behaving or badly behaving, their effects being different, of course, a mother, a person, okay? A person presenting itself, showing itself in the form of a unity to which or with which the child turns out to identify itself, okay? Now there are problems, however, as we have seen, the reality of the child is not unity. Okay? The reality of the child is far from being unity. The child is not at the stage of constituting its own self-unity in practical terms, in other words. Okay? So this means that this established unity reflecting itself from the mirror onto the cognition of the child, okay, turns out to be, with which the child identifies itself, okay, turns out to be an imaginary something. By imaginary, we mean fantastic, okay, having nothing to do with the reality, in other words. Okay. There was a very beautiful quotation, if I can find it. Okay, Lacan writes that, on that matter, the jubilant assumption of his, Lacan assumes that the child or the infant is a his, okay, this jubilant assumption of his specular image by the child at the infant stage still sunk in its motor incapacity, okay, and nursing dependence. So the child actually in its own reality is far from being a unity, even not capable of nursing its own self, therefore being dependent upon the other. Okay. Would seem to exhibit in an exemplary situation by the symbolic matrix in which the eye is precipitate. Some of the words you may not know here. I'm going to try to explain this. Precipitated in a primordial form before it is objectified in the dialectic of identification with the other and before the language restores to it in the universal its function as subject. The important point is that this form situates the agency of the ego before its social determination in a fictional direction which will always remain irreducible for the individual alone, or rather, which will only rejoin the coming into being of the subject asymptotically. This Gestalt form symbolizes the mental permanence of the I at the same time as it prefigures its alienating destination. Okay, checking my clock. Let's continue after the break.